Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the CKC channel again. We're having a super Saturday. And welcome to our lecture series, or my lecture series, How to Beat a Grandmaster, part 4. And this evening, we have a special guest. And just before I introduce him, I'd just like to thank everybody for joining me this morning for our first CKC Arena tournament, the first of many. And congratulations to the winners. First place goes to Mr. Dalika, very strong player. I actually lost to him round one in the tournament. He's from Serbia. And then his brother actually came second, also from Serbia, Grandmaster, Dual Master. And then third is our local master, Fire Master Banilevic. So congrats to everybody, and well done to everybody in the tournament. There's lots of tough games, and you can all catch, relive this tournament on YouTube. Of course, on Twitch you can also revisit it, but sometimes the quality of the live show is not always perfect. But I will upload this tournament. I've recorded it as well, and I will upload it onto YouTube for everybody to watch over and over again. So so now, without further ado, I would like to welcome you guys to our Saturday Night Live lecture and our special guest, International Master Rodwell Makoto. Welcome to the show, Rodwell.
Hello, everyone. Thanks, Calvin, for the invite.
It's great to have you here on the show. It's been a while coming. I think I wanted you on the show a long time ago. And of course, Rodwell has been playing, or he played in our last CKC match. Rodwell. So how is the lockdown treating you? How is the post CKC Invitational treating you?
Yeah. No, I've been enjoying the prize money.
That's a good one. Okay. I'm happy.
Yeah, the lockdown at the moment, I think we're now used to it now. It's now like a norm to almost everyone. I think after 100 or so days, it does become normal.
Yes.
And especially with the online tournaments and this kind of lectures, which is now, it seems everyone is doing it. So yes, so it's part of ours. It's a part of our chess play.
Aha, mm. Uh-huh. And of course, us human beings, we always seem to adapt. Doesn't matter what the circumstances are. So hopefully, we can also at some point get back to normal play. But for now, like you said, we're kind of getting used to it. So
yes.
All right, and like mentioned before, guys, Rodwell was our last CKC Invitational champion, just to show you an image of that quickly. And there we go. As you can see, the second CKC champion, first CKC champion was, of course, International Master Henry Steele, but Rodwell taking the second one. And he did quite a good job over there beating Joseph Mwale in the last round. Joseph, GM, aka GM Fear, also a fierce opponent. So so we are here to do our lecture on how to be the Grandmaster. Rodwell has prepared something nice for us over here, and before we get there, I would just like to ask Rodwell a couple of questions, just so that the viewers can get to know him a bit better. And of course, if the viewers out there, if you guys would like to also pop a question in the chat box, please feel free to do so. And hi, scariest name coming up with his famous greeting, what up? Okay, so welcome, scariest name, and let's start with the questions. Rodwell. So my first question is, first of all, when did you learn the game of chess? At what age did you learn the game of chess?
I learned when I was, I think, 19. It was very late for chess.
19.
Oh, sure. Nine. Okay, it was 9 or 10. Okay. I still remember, yeah, it was 97, yes.
Ah, yeah, that's about 9, 10, yeah. I think I'm, yes. Are you 87, born 87, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm also 87, yes. Yeah. Okay, all right.
So I learned that time, but no one taught me how to play chess. I learned from watching people playing, that's how I learned.
Oh.
Actually, you know, the guy who, you know, Amini,
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, he was the one because we in Zimbabwe we do stay 3 hours away from each other.
Aha. Oh, that's nice. Okay. So you that you just watch him play, or did he actually help you?
Yes. Okay. You know, I grew up in a township, so I used to go at his house. Then people used to come at his place and play chess.
Okay.
So I used to go there and watch. Yes. So it was just everyone used to come at his place, and people were playing there. And then I learned how to play chess at his house actually.
Oh, it's a small world, and I mean, Dawda Mini also a fierce chess player. Mm-hmm. We had him on the show as well, playing and yeah, I've played Dawda a couple of times in Cape Town, and he seems to be very fast on the clock and very strong at the same time. So interesting stuff over there. So and you know what, Rodwell, what's his name? Victor Korchnoi, was it Victor? Yeah, Victor. Okay, Bobby also. No, but I think Victor once said that, you know, there's a difference between when you start playing chess and when you actually start putting all your efforts and time into chess. Because, I mean, you can learn the game of chess at 7 and actually it's only start really putting effort into improving when you're 15 or whatever. But
yes.
When do you think you got serious about chess?
I got serious when I started to play in open events. That was 3-4 years later, 2001.
Okay.
4 years. Then my very first game of an open event was against Eric Takawira.
Oh, okay. Another.
That's how we were.
Okay.
Yes, that's how we became friends, because my very first game, I played Karokan, you know.
Uh-huh.
So since then, I never played Karokan in my life.
Okay. So.
Okay, it's because. I mean, he used to show me the games of Karpov in Karokan. So I started to play Karokan since I was, that was one of my first openings. Then later on, I met Eric in the open event, in the tournament.
Yes.
And then, I got clapped. And then I said, no, we play Karokan again. So he started to show me some lines. That's how I got involved into serious chess at adult level.
Interesting stuff. So sometimes in your chess career, some specific moment can influence someone into going into a certain direction. I can definitely attest to that as well. So, and welcome Milkshake. Milkshake says hi. And Scariest Name says King Kotov. Do you know who's Scariest Name, Rodwell?
Scariest Name.
He's from Cape Town. And I'm
Michael James, isn't that like Michael James?
No, that's close. Michael James also knows him. So everybody, the reason why I don't like to
isn't that Vero?
Yes, it's Vero. I was gonna say I don't like revealing people's names, but everybody on the show knows already. So welcome. Okay, let's get on with the questions. I know everybody is keen to see Rodwell's game. Right, let's see. And now another question is, growing up, and of course you excelled in chess, and I want to know from you, what do you think made you excel and separate yourself from your peers? What did you do that you think made you excel differently or just separate yourself from other players?
There might be so many factors, actually. You know, when I was growing up, I grew up with my cousin, who was also a strong player.
Okay.
Then there was also another friend of mine who was also strong, but I was the weakest one amongst the three.
Okay. It's always good. So you were in good company.
Yes. So I was the weakest one. But I think, when you're young, you play all different kind of openings, Sicilian and these aggressive openings.
Yes.
So I had to change my play. So I decided, no, I think I have to go and play. I have to play something different.
Yes.
These guys just play Sicilian. They play aggressive stuff. Let me play something which is more positional.
Yes.
That's when I decided to realize my play is not aggressive player. I'm just a positional player.
Aha. Uh-huh.
So I changed my openings and my style very quickly. I said, no, I'm not going to go into this. And I did rise very rapidly to win national championships and other strong tournaments in Zim.
Okay.
That's when I started to separate from the rest of the guys.
All right, and
the,
Is that now that is... from realizing, first of all, what do you think, what was your own style and what to work on? Or?
Yes. I realized my style at a very early stages of when I was young. I did realize, no, I should play a position of what? Position of play.
Okay. And what I like also what you're saying is that you grew up around amongst strong players and you kind of noticed what they played. And sometimes you need to be exposed to different things to realize, in fact. I mean, because if you've only seen Sicilian your whole life, how do you know you're good in E5 if you haven't looked around? So that's interesting.
They were playing Sicilian all the time and I was playing it, but I was winning, but... it was just, this is not right. Yeah, there's something wrong.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yes.
All right. And, by the way, Dr. Queenie WIM says, greetings from the Reflector. Okay, so the Reflector has hacked Dr. Queenie WIM's account. And so the Reflector says, hi, welcome to the show, Reflector. I think you might know the Reflector as well, Rodwell. He reflects a lot. And. King Ulster, I hope I'm pronouncing it right. I was thinking about that name the other day, King Ulster. I was thinking, what is the spelling? Am I saying, isn't it maybe King Lester or something? But I see there's no L in front of that. So I hope I'm saying it correctly. King Ulster says, hi, gents. Question for host and guest. Did your planned routines and actual routines change since IM and FM level? So I'll leave that all up to you, Rodwell. I would give a short answer. My routines and plans didn't change much, but maybe you have a nicer story about your path to becoming an IM and so on. So the question is, did your planned routines and actual routines change since IM level?
Yes. It was sort of like a forced change, is it? Because you know, I moved from Zim to down here in South Africa, and then you start meeting us and stuff.
Yes.
Because I became an IM 7 years ago when I was down here, so the routine, of course, it changed because I'm now in a new environment, a new country, so I had to adjust.
So, are you saying that you more or less at the time that you moved to South Africa, you became an IM?
Yes, I became an IM when I came down here because you start to meet stronger players, not all the time, you start to. Because here down here you meet different type of players.
Okay.
Because there's so many types of players than back in Zim. Because in Zim there's I think one dimension players.
Okay.
Then here there's if you go to Pretoria to meet different players. If you come to Joburg there's different players. Then there's different players. Yes. So there's always so I had to adjust and adapt to the situation, to the new environment. And I think I improved. I think maybe 2010, 2011, that's when I really worked on my chest. And then I think I dropped a little bit there.
All right. Thanks, Rodwell. I hope that answers some questions there, King Ulster. And we're getting closer to the business end of this evening, but a few more questions. So next up, Rodwell, I know there's lots and lots of achievements under your belt. But I want to know from you, maybe from a personal point of view, what are your personal greatest achievements in chess? Maybe greatest victories or tournament victories or anything like that. What's your greatest achievements? Maybe three, if you can mention.
I think winning SA Open was probably the greatest achievement. Yes.
SA Open, 2012, right?
Yes, I thought I was going to win it again, but it does become difficult.
The idea of getting into a situation where you're almost winning it, that sounds lovely to me, Rodwell. I would definitely agree with you. That's one of one achievement you don't want to miss out on. So SA Open 2012, and I believe there was a couple of GMs playing in that tournament, eh? Was Adley playing? GM Adley was playing. There was another GM from... Portugal, I think.
France and Portugal, yes.
Tal,
yes.
And I drew against one of those GMs that tournament.
I think
Hernandez or something.
Fernandez. Yes.
So you won that tournament with at least three GMs playing in that. So
yes.
That was
okay, and then there's a funny story, you know, about that tournament, about 2012.
Yeah.
Then that same year, I went to the Olympiad in Turkey, 2012. So I was sitting with this guy from Sudan. didn't know that it was me who won the SA Open in 2012.
Okay.
So then he started to say, no, this guy who won a tournament, 2-1, who won a tournament ahead of Grandmasters. So it
was me. How did you break the news to him?
I said, I didn't break the news.
Yeah, interesting stuff. Okay, yeah, no, I don't think I would have resisted. I would have told him, hey, that's me. okay, anyway, so that's maybe anything else you have in mind for greatest achievements? Of course, maybe getting your IM title, I would also, from my side.
Yes, getting an IM title, I can put it there, but I don't think, but I think beating a Grandmaster is one of the best feelings. You can,
of course,
you do it if you're not a Grandmaster.
Of course,
it's one of those feelings. Yes, getting a title is it's a big achievement. Yes, maybe I'm used to it now. Maybe that's what I don't feel like.
Yes.
But I think winning. I think any win against a Grandmaster is probably one of the best achievements.
No matter what,
it's one of the greatest feelings.
Yes. Okay, great. Fantastic. So let's see. Couple of more notes, Dr. Queen. Okay, Reflector says Tal and Gallego and Adli. I'm not sure about Gallego, though. It might be Fernandez.
No, Gallego wasn't there. It was Fernandez.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. And then Babiki says, hello, guys. Makoto, what was your favorite chess destination to play a tournament at? What was your favorite destination?
I think nothing will compare to Norway, Tromso, actually. Tromso was the best.
I heard you guys had a lot of salmon over there. I didn't make the Olympia that time.
Yes. It was, besides the fish and stuff, but it was a beautiful area, and it was it's far, and where you get, you do feel the experience of that midnight sun, that was the best. Yes, the midnight sun, yes.
Very interesting, yeah. So the whole atmosphere and everything was cool over there, not just the tournament itself. Okay, and then maybe two last questions. Maybe from your perspective, benefits of playing chess. Are there any, and what do you think, if there are? What's the benefits of playing chess?
Okay, from my own experience, you do have good memory, to be honest. You do remember stuff. Okay, Yes, and there are so many, the concentration levels and the focus level, they do go high. And a chess game is not just only a game. You do get so many benefits, like the ones I mentioned, memory, concentration, and focus. Yes. And also, you're just a creativity. You do become a creativity person,
yes,
just in the outside world of chess.
Yes, I fully agree.
You don't only use it only in chess. You can also use it outside in chess world in some other aspect. Yes.
Yes, agreed, and maybe also what I've also I received comments, not just about myself but other chess players as well, from non-chess playing people saying that we always analyze too much. Different situations, you want to just analyze completely. Maybe it's my over-prophylaxis kicking in.
I think it's also a downside for a chess player, where sometimes in a simple situation, we do tend to overanalyze it. Maybe there's a simple, we tend to overanalyze it, where we just need a simple decision to what to do.
Yes.
Then the other benefit is also decision-making. You do make a... Yes,
very important there. So, okay, thanks. It sounds like if you're not playing chess and you're watching this show, there you've received a lot of reasons why you should start playing chess. And then my last question for you, before we get going with the game, is who is your favorite player, chess player, and maybe why or anything like that. Who's your favorite chess player?
Like I said, that tournament, CKC second tournament, I said Aronian, is it? Aronian is my favorite player because of his style, is it?
Yes.
I started to like him 2005 when he won the World Cup in 2005.
Okay.
And yes, of course, if you look at, yes.
Sorry, Araunian, okay. Araunian also plays E5, and he plays that type of style that I know you also like to play. It's not just a dry E5, it's actually also enterprising. So, okay, it's linking up now. It's kind of making sense to me.
Yes, and then but I don't like, I know he likes D4, D5, but that's why we don't agree. Yes.
Okay, so yeah, Aronian as well. So guys, check out 11 Aronian's games. That's what Makoto is also hinting there. Myself, I also, Levon Aronian is also one of my favorite players. So definitely someone to watch. So, okay, I think that I've held you back enough now, Rodwell. I think we can now switch over to the studio and let's get to the board. Okay, here we go. So we are at the chessboard. And all right, Rodwell, so this is now, where are we now? We're at the last Olympiad, Georgia Batumi.
Okay, this was the last Olympiad I played Batumi 2018. Okay, this was round 9.
Yes.
In the previous round, we played Cuba.
Okay.
So we lost bad. We lost like 3.5 to 1/2. I only got a half. So I was the only guy who got a half.
Okay, okay. So you at least were steering the ship with your draw at least. Okay.
So then we got this ICC International. I'm not sure what is CCCD. I know it's the dev team.
Yeah, I know. I read up a bit as well. They said that Gruenfeld can't... he's deaf.
Yes.
So yeah, yes, okay, I get you.
You can't talk, you can't hear, yes.
It's
yes,
almost
yes,
like
yes.
a disabled team, so to speak.
Yes, yes, yeah. With the disability, yes. Yeah, but you know, in this tournament, he beat Andrew Kayonde very well. He destroyed him.
Yes, I actually didn't check that game, right? Because Andrew was playing good, wasn't he? Actually, didn't he draw to Ivanchuk?
Yes, he drew Ivanchuk.
Yes, and then...
He played this guy in a couple of rounds. Then okay. Yes, you go, you got dented. So then I was okay, maybe next.
All right.
So I had to prepare. Yeah, I prepared in the morning. I prepared. I looked for E4, E5.
Yeah.
Then I was quite happy with my preparation. You know, when you are happy, you are satisfied with the preparation. Then I said, okay, now I'm ready to play.
Yes. And sorry, Rodwell. So you playing on board 1 for Zimbabwe? You playing against?
Against ICC. Yes.
Ah, okay. And Gruenfeld, from which country is he? Is he from Israel?
Israel.
He's
yes,
from Israel.
Grandmaster
from Israel.
Yes.
Okay, cool.
Yes.
And by the way, one last thing. It's very interesting to me that Rodwell was playing a grandmaster called Gruenfeld, and one of his favorite openings is the Gruenfeld.
Yes.
Just something interesting over there. But anyway, Rodwell, you can continue. So, Rodwell, you had the black pieces.
Yes, I had the black pieces. So, with my preparation, I looked at his previous tournament games of E4, E5. Then I was happy with what I was going to face, actually.
Okay.
I was anticipating the main lines of E4, E5, and then Bishop Ray Lopez. So then I was quite happy with my preparation, saying, okay, this is going to be good. A good game.
So, nice.
Then, so E4, let's start E4, yeah. E5. So okay. This wasn't a surprise. So knight F3, knight C6.
Yeah.
Then knight C3, move number 3. Ooh. That's where I got a surprise now.
Okay. Okay. So yes. There goes the prep out the window.
Yeah, you know how it feels, you know, when the preparation does go out of the window.
Yeah.
But, and of course, but as you should do prepare, you should be ready for this, you should be ready for anything.
Yes.
Yes, especially if you're playing on board 1, you can't just go and,
and
rock up and play.
Yes.
Okay, so knight C3, and then knight F6.
Okay.
Okay, I'm just going to check where is he going to go. Then bishop B5.
Okay.
So, yeah, that's where I started to think now. I think I took some couple of minutes thinking what I'm going to do here.
And,
so, because I'm already out of the preparation.
Yeah. And
yes,
tell me, have you faced this line a lot previously? Are you?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So, that's a good thing. Okay.
Yes. So now I was wondering, now my mind is now running around, my mind is now running up to look for those, to retrieve those previous games now in the database. That's the one. Okay, which games are in the database of this variation, which of this I'm facing now? So I realized I've got two games of this. Of what? Of this opening.
Two of your own games.
Yes.
So that now we're thinking, what is this? What has this GM cooked up for you?
Yes. Uh-huh. So now I was thinking. So the first one I played was 2016, the previous Olympiad, 2016 in Baku.
Okay.
Yes. In Baku, I played Bishop C5 against some guy from Kuwait.
All right.
Yeah, so it was so he played, and then I played a funny gambit here. Yeah,
okay.
Which I played a funny gambit. So it worked out very well.
Oh, and that's interesting.
Yes, what's it worked out very well with the opening. Yes, because he misplayed it, but I got some good play with
Wow, that's also an interesting game in itself.
Yeah, so then I got some play and then...
So you just sacked a piece there for play?
Yeah, no, because, you know, if you go back on move number after knight takes F2, bishop takes F2.
Yeah.
Yes. Because if I look here, there's a bishop on B5, which is hanging.
Yeah.
So I might have some counter chances against it.
Yes.
Then at the same time, after knight takes E4...
Yes.
The king, it doesn't have a really good square.
Yes.
So, for example, after knight takes e4,
yeah,
the king can't go to g1 because I've got queen f6. For example, king g1, I've got queen f6 with queen b6. Now I'm hitting one.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
Okay, so you're trying to expose that bishop that's hanging there on b5.
Yes.
So
anyway, so I was now looking at, I thought, okay, you prepared for this now.
Uh-huh.
So I'm going to go for bishop c5.
And by the way, bishop c5, it doesn't look like the main move, is it? Is knight d4 also option here? I'm not an e5
no,
player.
Yes, I know, but there's a knight knight d4 stuff.
Yeah, it's
so
also...
So I don't want to go into this mainline stuff.
Yeah,
here.
Okay.
Yes. So, you know...
You know what, Rodwell, sometimes I struggle, the same thing with Barish. I struggle to take away the arrows if you can just left-click somewhere here.
Yes.
Yeah,
gotcha.
There we go. Because sometimes I don't know why I can't remove the arrows easily. Okay, What now? So not bishop c5, not knight d4. Did you have another weapon in store?
No, then the other game was against Henku. Henku Duplessis.
Okay, Henku also played, a tough player, yeah?
Yes, I played bishop b4.
Symmetrical, okay. Ah, okay.
Yes,
there's some old classic games with Botvinnik them playing these type of things, with bishop g5 and then black goes, what? Takes.
Yes, bishop g5, h7. Knight e7 and stuff.
Yeah.
There's a nice game between, what's his name again? Nesipiniau versus Ponomariov.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay,
so,
I must check that out. Nesipiniau and Ponomariov.
Yes, nice.
All right.
Yes, so black one. So then I said, I'm not going for this now. I'm not going for this.
Yeah.
So I'm surprised. I have to surprise him, actually.
Yes.
I have to surprise you.
Yes.
Otherwise, I can't play bishop c5, I can't play bishop b4. So those two he prepared.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, if I don't have anything. So now I do remember, the game. I know Carlsen played some other game, with bishop d6.
Ah. Ooh,
yes.
Interesting stuff. You know what?
Yes, so then I'm going to play bishop d6.
Bishop d6.
So the idea is, of course, if they do take it out, the bishop does look good now. So
yes.
This bishop is now free to come out.
Yes, that would make perfect sense. Now the bishop on d6 is there naturally. I was going to say, I've seen this bishop d6, and the first time I saw this bishop d6, not in this position, it gives you a weird feeling. It looks a bit off, but it's actually very solid. And I must admit, I think I saw you maybe once play this bishop d6 move against what the Evans Gambit or something. There's also a line where you go bishop
Gambit,
d6.
Evans Gambit. Yes.
Yeah.
Evans
so,
Gambit.
Okay. So yeah, this would make sense if he takes on c6. But what did he do?
Okay. He didn't do that. So if we look here, he played d3. But Carlsen and Christian versus Carlsen, they went for 0-0 and 0-0, and then it was some other game. Then they drew later.
Okay, and if I may ask you here, after castles and castles, what's the long term plan with this bishop? Are you gonna put it on c5 later on? Are you planning to castle and play a rook e8 or what's the idea?
No, I think you have to see exactly what is white going to do.
Yeah.
So like castling and bishop c5 is what part of the what? Of the plan, castling the bishop c5 is part of the main plan actually.
Okay.
Because you just want to see how white is going to play. Actually.
Okay.
You want to go into those kind of symmetric lines. I didn't want to go into the symmetric lines.
Uh-huh. Yes. Okay. Okay, yes. That's interesting stuff. Playing for the one with the black pieces against the GM. I like it. All right, let's see what happens. So after bishop d6, d3. Oh, and by the way, Scariest Name says there's a lot of Rubenstein games in this too. Yeah, Rubenstein also has such games.
Yes, for sure.
Okay, right. So D3?
D3, played A6.
Uh-huh.
So now, like I said, I was now on my own here. Yeah? I'm no longer relying on my preparation, because my preparation just went out of the window, move number 3.
Uh-huh.
So I'm now on my own. So I'm trying to adjust, because I do play Archangel. That variation.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to get into that kind of a system so that at least I'm in something which
familiar territory, structural.
Yes, I'm comfortable.
Yeah.
I don't want to go, because this was my, to be honest, this was my first time to play this bishop d6 on the board.
Sure. Okay.
Yes.
All right.
So because I was surprised, I had to look something different, because the moment I played bishop d6, it took some time. If I'm not mistaken, it took some.
And that's usually a good sign against the GM.
Yes.
It's usually a good sign. Yeah.
So then I realized, oh, okay, at least, got you there.
Nice. Okay, right. So A4 probably back, right?
Yeah, bishop A4, then B5.
Right.
Bishop B3, now bishop C5. So we're now into sort of like that kind of archangel system.
Yes. So
we are following, D6 and bishop B7.
And we're back into Ray Lopez territory.
Yes. But now this line is a little bit tricky, this positional line of knight c3, because they tend to bring it on what? On d5 and bishop d5 quickly.
Yes.
Okay, yes. Uh-huh. So anyway, after bishop c5, bishop g5, it came quickly.
Immediately.
So now I can castle, I can play d6. You're going to be in a situation, for example, if you do castle, then knight d5, now you have to put your bishop on e7. It's now a little bit awkward for this bishop now, because it moved
sure.
Then it had to go back
to
again.
e7. Yeah, yes. No, it's a lot.
So now white can take on e7, then queen on e7. There's a permanent pin along that diagonal on h4, d8 diagonal.
Yes.
This pin. So it won't be easy to break.
Exactly. And if black goes here, you drop back, and g5 could be very dangerous.
Break.
Mm.
Yeah.
And white has the bishop pay already, so that could be a long term thing as well.
Yeah, because the moment he plays a3 or c3, it's going to be difficult for black actually.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, so you can't allow that.
Yeah. So after bishop g5, so this is something new to me. So you have to play what is there on the board, to be honest. What is really there?
Uh-huh.
What the position is demanding.
Yes.
Okay. So then h6.
Just to cut.
So in this, when I played h6, I was worried about bishop h4, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
Because I didn't like bishop h4. It's an annoying move, because the moment he plays bishop h4, I may continue with g5, because white does have options of long casting. Yes, and shown his options of short castling.
Yes. And it's interesting, after you play a move like g5, you mentioned now white could long castle, and black has already expanded on both sides. So it's going
to
be difficult.
Where are you put your king?
It's going to be difficult
also,
for the king, yeah.
Yes. Okay. It might be playable position. It might be a playable position, but the question, where are you going to put the what?
The king. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. So that would have been interesting.
Yes.
Yeah, maybe you could go back to e7. Bishop e7.
That was the main plan. Okay, so I didn't think about it. I didn't think much, but I was saying, okay, what is he going to play? But anyway, you too quickly on F6, so then I sort of didn't have to think about it.
Yes, lovely. Okay, yes. So he gains the d5 square for that, I'm assuming.
Yes, so queen takes and losing the bishop. Knight then d5 immediately. Queen back to d8.
Okay.
Yes. So c3. Yeah, I played a reckless move, to be honest.
All right.
Yes, that was a reckless move I played. I played d6, castling.
Castling.
Low shot castling.
Now, Rodwell, you need to explain this to the viewers out there, because castling to most of us seems like the one of the most safest moves to play. And now, coming from you, please explain to us strategically what's going on, because you consider castling being reckless. Is there anything more urgent at hand here?
Because the moment you do castle, the center is not safe is not strong enough from the black side. Because after d4, so let's say, for example, like what happened in the game, castling and then d4. I don't have center anymore.
Yeah, the e5 square is now too much pressure on it. The bishop can't drop back, because then this just crumbles. So are you saying that maybe was d6 a better option?
By far. d6 was a better option.
So if d4, then you could at least drop back somewhere.
Now I can drop back with the bishop to a7. Then I still have my center.
Okay.
Yes. You're going to see it in the long run, what I'm talking about here.
All right.
Yes. So you're going to see it in the long run, what I'm talking about.
Castle d4?
Okay. So after castling d4, and also I did underestimate this d4. I said, okay, d4, I can't do that because this king is still in the center. Because I was playing with his mind, I think he can't do that because his king is on the center.
Yes.
But he did that anyway. So I have to prove it.
That's one of the toughest things to handle, lay on the board. When you do something and you expect your opponent can't do it, and he does it anyway.
Yes. Then no, he can't do that because his king is on the center. But I have got rookie 8 and stuff. Then I realized, but no, I don't have time. I don't have a good square for the bishop. I thought, you can play bishop b4, but you can't with this knight. You can't play bishop b6. You don't have a proper square or a good square for the bishop.
Yes.
So my bishop is just getting harassed. So after d4, I took e takes d4, then c takes d4. Then bishop a7.
So look, okay. what I can at least see, the one benefit, even though you gave up your center, like these bishops, like there's some pressure on the center, at least from black's point of view, that white needs to kind of protect the whole time. So there's some pressure that I don't know if the bishop's going to go to b7 or not, that white has got some responsibility protecting his center. That might be the other thing. And the e-file is open. Maybe a rook.
Yes, because you are. So yes.
And King Ulster is mentioning something here, just maybe ironically saying, Makoto said you cannot rock up on board one just without any, I guess, without any preparation. So on. But now he says, I'll see what white is doing. Lol. So, but yeah, okay. But that's the game of chess. You sometimes you can't be prepared for everything.
No, you can easily get out prepared. You can't prepare for anything. You can prepare some the whole day. This guy, I never saw, I think I saw maybe one of the old games he played like way back, like 10, 15 years ago, he played D4, but there were not so many. So I didn't bother to check the D4 lines, but if he did play D4, I was going to be really surprised, you know?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so now bishop A7.
So bishop A7, then, okay, so now I'm considering castling because this king, I've got rook 8 and stuff. But he played rook c1, which was also a strong move again.
Okay. So you can't play d6 yet?
I can't play d6 yet. I can't play d6.
Okay.
Rook c. Yeah. So now there's a problem with this c7 pawn.
Ah, that as well. Some good coordination between those two guys. Okay.
Now, I don't have any center. That's the problem. I don't have any center. So it can't be figured out. So the moves like rook e8. For example, like rookie 8, I was looking at this stuff, rookie 8, and then there's castling. So if you try to take here, there's going to be bishop c2, and here, there's going to be queen d3.
Oh.
No, you're opening up lines for the pieces. You don't want to do that.
Yeah, this doesn't look kosher. Yeah,
if you go G6 rookie one, if you go for example G6 rookie one, now this threat of takes knight F6. If you take this, another threat again.
Oh my word! Take,
and then if D6, there's rook E8.
You're
losing no variations.
Okay.
You don't want to be in this kind of situation. I said, no, I don't want to take that pawn on E4. So you can't play rook E8 and it's going for the what? For the pawn.
Yes. So
the main problem for Black now, he doesn't have a center, number one. Number two, he doesn't have a minor piece on the king side.
Yes. That's a problem.
That's a huge problem for what? For Black.
Mm-hmm.
So the problem, even if there's a minor piece, where is it going to sit on the king side? Let's say there's a minor piece. Where is it going to sit?
Oof. F6 is on not F6, available.
You can't really sit because in some of the lines you can get chased away with E5.
Yes.
On G6, maybe you could invite H4, H5.
Yes.
I wasn't comfortable. I was happy with C5 for like about like 3-4 moves back, but because I played castling, can you see where there's a problem on move number 11? Because I played this castling move, which was a reckless move. So now I'm now in this kind of situation because of what? Castling. I don't have any center, and there's no minor piece on the what? On the king side. So rook C1, bishop B7. I said, okay, let me continue and we'll see.
Okay, right.
Then castling. So now white is probably happy with this. Now it's my, I have to develop the pieces or connect the rooks to the center and see how it's going to be. So I played rook C8 so that I can chase away the knight on D5. Because that's the strongest piece at the moment.
Okay, so you're working hard here to get that knight away.
Okay, because I was thinking in some of the lines, when I was thinking of playing, I didn't remember. I have to remember exactly what I was thinking during that time, actually. I had to play...
In fact, Rodwell, let me just take a moment here and correct my background here. I think it's getting dark, the side. But yeah, you can continue. I'm listening.
Okay. So bishop B7, then here. Yeah, I was thinking of playing something like knight A5.
Okay.
It was an interesting move. Knight A5.
All right, knight A5. I'm just getting myself back on here. Okay, there we go. I'm in. Okay. So knight A5.
Knight A5. Knight takes B3. Knight takes B3. Queen takes. Is it queen? No, sorry.
Okay, I'm with you now. Okay.
Okay, I think rook C8 first. Then knight d5, then takes, queen takes, takes, pawn takes, then bishop. Takes, then takes. Can you see that?
Yes.
So
this was another
variation which I saw I can go for.
Yes.
But I'm pawn down. I'm pawn down.
Yeah, but it's okay at least because these double pawns don't make a good impression.
Yes. So I was thinking of that. But then I said, how am I going to get those pawns now? That's the question. How am I going to get those? Because the pawn is... These pawns, they can look weak, but if you're not able to attack them, they're not a real weakness, is it?
Yes.
Yes. Because you have to prove that, yes, it's a weakness, but how are you going to be able to attack them? Because I do also have problems also on A6.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And in some other lines, the knight can come to E5 attacking D7.
Aha.
Yes. So I wasn't sure, how am I going to continue with this variation? Maybe with queen a8, I'll be allowing like move like queen c7. Uh-huh. So how am I going to attack that pawn immediately? Queen a8, this queen c7. So it was kind of what should I do? I don't want to. So I said, no, let me just skip this variation. Nah,
okay. All right. Yes. Makes sense. Yeah.
Why should
makes
I sense. Give a pawn? Why should I give a pawn? Mm-hmm. For personal play, but okay, maybe I get some compensation, but I don't see anything out of it.
Yeah, and I like the way you're explaining it, Rodwell, because a lot of times, especially against strong, very strong players like GMs, sometimes your nerves get the best of against the best of you, and you tend to make decisions faster, or you sometimes I can easily see someone or myself making a decision like this. Okay, let's go knight a5. I'm under pressure. I don't know what to do. c7 is on, and then we go into this variation and we don't properly evaluate the end result, and like you were evaluating here, and you are holding your nerves here, and you're saying, no, but I'm not happy yet. Let's just hold the tension for a bit longer. So I think for a bit longer against tough opponents is very important. I guess that's what makes you a tough player in the first place. So yeah, interesting stuff. So what happened now?
So after I played rook c8, I didn't want to go for the knight a5, and then okay. I said okay. Then he played queen d3. I said well.
Okay. So h7. We eyeing h7 over here. So
yes. Now the bishop c2 is now the agenda. Now this kind of diagonal is going to be a problem.
Yes,
it's going to be a problem. So what should I do with this? It's coming, and you can't really stop it. You can't really stop it.
Yeah, it's like a slow wave coming at you.
Yes. Okay, so I said I need to bring a piece on the king side. Knight e7 to destabilize the knight on...
Finally, we're trying to challenge this knight on d5.
Yes, but now my c7 is defended, so there's no problem. So knight f4, he's trying to keep the pieces. At the same time, the knight is hovering towards to the king side.
Yes.
So this knight is going h5 or whatever towards that side, and there's still also this idea is still there. So yeah.
And the guy's controlling the whole center here as well.
Yes, so. Like if I pawn, these problems are not there. Can you see? Why I needed the e5 pawn.
Yeah.
So I played just a normal move d6. Then bishop c2.
Okay,
so now my mind is now running around now. The way he beat Andrew, I said, no, because it was similar to this. His pieces were pointing to the king.
Okay.
So I said, I was going to become another victim. I said, I'm going to become another victim. Yeah, with this, because he played it very well. He attacked it very well.
Okay.
So I said, oh no, I have to defend. So yeah, if I still remember, I had 1 hour, 7 minutes or so.
Okay.
So I thought for about 10 minutes. The more you think about this, if you do think for more than 10 minutes or 15 minutes, you're going to play a blunder or a mistake.
Yes, I know that theory, yeah.
Yes, so then I said, no, I'm just going to play. Otherwise, the moment if I try to keep thinking, I'm going to make a serious blunder. Mm-hmm. So I was so sure how am I going to defend this kind of position. Should I go g6 early? Should I wait? If I've named g6, what should I do? So I was a little bit in a sort of like a panic mode.
Mm-hmm. Yo, I'm actually trying to think here myself. I'm not so, it's not an easy position.
Yes. I thought for 10 minutes and then I made a mistake actually.
Is F5 possible or is it just suicide?
Nah, F5 is a suicide, goes to 96.
Ooh, okay, that's just a aula over there I'm thinking of.
Yes.
What did you do?
I played knight g6,
Okay, so now...
Knight g6 wasn't the best variation. I'm not sure I even know what does it say. What is the best variation here? What is the best move? Sorry.
And Rodwell, scariest name says here in the comments, I remember watching this live and feeling very uncomfortable. Okay. So I can feel it. I can feel a scariest name. Yeah, so knight g6, I mean you're walking on toes here. And knight takes g6, what's happening here? You want this?
No, yes, knight takes g6, h takes g6. My
e5
plan was
e5 is nothing, you can just take on f3 or what?
On f3, yes. That was the plan. I had to counter.
And there's no mate on h7. So,
no, if he plays there, I play queen g. Now I'm able to attack on g2. So there's nothing.
Okay, nice. So nice counterplay.
Take, and then, everything's going to diffuse.
Then even d4, you can play bishop d4 and so on.
Yeah, bishop d4 too. Yes.
Okay, so that's a nice active way to defend over there. So knight g6. So knight g6 doesn't make too much sense. So what does he do? The knight on f4 is hanging. Can he go e5 immediately?
Because even after the game, he doesn't talk. He spoke about knight g6, actually. That was a good. So he gave me a thumbs up. That was a good defense.
Yes. Yes,
that
I agree.
Very well. He defended very well on that g6.
Yeah, nice.
Oh, well, okay.
So my question to you is e5?
No, e5, what was the plan again? No,
I was just taking...
I was going to f3 again. I was going to take on f3.
Take on f3, yeah. Because there's no real threat, really, that white has.
Yes.
This knight on g6 is blocking everything. The whole, that one piece that you were talking about, that's the, he's the star right now. Okay, so that makes sense. Yeah, okay, that makes, I actually need to...
Otherwise, if I don't have the minor piece on the king side, then now I'm forced to move pawns. You know, you don't want to touch pawns, especially like a grandmaster. Mm-hmm. You don't want to touch pawns. You touch pawns, you're for weaknesses.
Right.
So...
King Arthur was saying c5 over there. But c5? Oh,
no, yeah. C5 is a computer move, to be honest. I thought of that, but I didn't... when I checked on the computer, you were suggesting c5. But you can't play c5 when it's like this, to be honest.
With mate lurking around, you must consider e5.
You can't play... Okay, it was part of my thinking, but I said I'm not going to play like this. Who's going to play like this?
Yeah, no, see, it is a cold move to make, c5.
Yes.
Interesting idea there, King Ulster. Okay, so knight g6 was played. How did he respond?
He played knight h5, which I think it was a mistake on his side, because I was worried. But just taking, then bishop b3 check, maybe.
Ah, so you considered that to be the best. Okay.
Yeah. But anyway, okay, c5, now c5.
Okay.
Then d5 is now blocking one of the diagonals, but you can't block all of them. Difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Queen e7. Knight g3.
Okay, so f5 is maybe something to be concerned about.
Yes.
I would think. But I mean, with a knight on g6, why worry?
Yes, but now everything, I was now a little bit feeling confident and comfortable a little bit, because I do have one diagonal open. My worry is the bishop on b7.
Yes,
but
of course.
I was pretty much confident that at least I'm not going to get wiped off now. At least I do have some chances now.
Yes. And of course, that bishop on a7 is a monster all of a sudden on that diagonal.
Yes.
He does, especially with the white not having his, did I make a move here? With white not having his dark-squared bishop on the board as well. Okay, so queen c3.
Yes. Queen c3, and then I played knight e5, so that if he does take, pawn takes, then I can get hold of the d4 square. Then, so for example, if knight takes, pawn takes, I do have the d4 square for my bishop. So if I can play queen here, and then maybe g6 later on, chasing away the knight, h5, g6.
Yes.
Then I've got the bishop, chase away the knight, then I've got the bishop d4. So I do have a strong what? Yes, for my bishop there.
Okay, and a lot of times, inexperienced players would think that now you're giving white a protected passed pawn, but the passed pawn isn't going anywhere, and that's queen d4 so wonderful for you. And you've got this 3-2 on the queen side, where if the bishop is standing on d4, can support very well as well. So,
because if you give something to your opponent, you must get something in return. That's how it is. Must get something. You don't have something in return, you're waste.
Yes.
Yes, you're waste. You must have something. You must have some leverage on something. If you like here, you white will get a passed pawn is white, but I'll get that d4 square in the outside passed pawn. Yes.
Okay, so queen c3, your opponent is still eyeing the king side, this g7, knight f5.
With knight f5 stuff, yes. So I just blocked there immediately. Knight f5,
queen f6. And I would like to pause here.
Yes.
And you say you were feeling much better now that you've at least...
Now I was way overconfident now. Now my confidence now up in the sky now. My confidence was now way high, way up in the sky.
Okay, lovely. So to the first glance, I would say, okay, the knights look menacing around the king. And I would actually maybe challenge the viewers out there to maybe give a suggestion on what black can play here. What do you guys think out there? What did Rodwell play over here? Or what would you play in this position? Without giving the move, Rodwell, can you maybe tell us a bit more about the position? What about I don't know if you can remember what was your opponent's look like during the game at this point? Was it like, okay, still very confident?
For Bishop C2, he was no longer confident as he was like previous moves back, like when Bishop C2 stuff, when he played Bishop C2, he was walking around. But the moment I started to get this position, he wasn't looking a little bit, he was looking a little bit uncomfortable actually.
Okay, so yeah, yes. He started to realize that it's not going to be so easy actually.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
So, but me, I was here. That's where I was. You know, I was excited. I got overexcited when I this position actually.
Okay.
I got overexcited. Yes.
All right. So, okay. It doesn't seem like anybody has a suggestion here. So, Rodwell, what did you play over here?
Because I had 40 minutes. And then the guy was sitting on 15.
Ah, okay. So he was obviously then feeling the pressure.
Yes.
Okay.
Now this time.
Yes.
So yeah, like I said, I was overexcited. I rushed. Yeah, I was very hasty to play this move. Instead of playing a prophylaxis move, then you can go on with your play.
Okay, makes sense. I got an idea what you're saying right now, but before you give the move, we've got queen please here. Finally someone suggesting something, Rodwell. Queen please is suggesting pawn to b4. Let's see, maybe a5 later, she says. Can white maybe not just capture queen please?
Bishop is hitting b7 and d6 too,
and d6 is also hanging. Is there any particular idea you have behind that? The knight isn't hanging on d4 because the other knight is supporting him. So something doesn't look completely right over there. If you could maybe explain what the idea is. But it looks like Black gave away a pawn and is under attack now. So maybe not that, but thanks for suggesting queen, please. Maybe that won't work out immediately. Seems like white can just accept your gift over there. Thanks, queen, please. Okay, Rodwell, so you were excited about playing a move. You were talking about maybe thinking properly. Okay, let me ask you, if you had taken more time, What would you have maybe played? Yeah.
Yes, if I've taken more time, because I was excited, you know, that adrenaline rush, you know, you want to make a move because you think you are getting something out of it, you know. That kind
yes.
of thing.
and by the way, more comments over here. Queen please says, my apologies, I don't know if you male or female here, but queen please says, snap, I missed. Lol, I haven't had much sleep. Okay, so our viewers saying they didn't get much sleep. No problem. And King Ulster is suggesting G6, and Scariest Name is suggesting King H7. What do you think, Rodwell?
I played G6. That's the move which I played, which wasn't the best.
Okay.
That was the move I played.
So you play G6, so you say it's not the best, but I kind of like it still. So that is what King Ulster recommended. We're going to get to this interesting move. But what's the other move that you...
after this, my confidence went downwards after that. Because G6 does give play to Black. The best move here was H5.
Aha. I like
this
that move.
Was a pro...
So you're threatening H5. G6.
Now I'm threatening G6. He's not taking on H6.
So you're not giving a pawn at least. You're
I'm not giving
it.
And my threat is still there.
Okay. I like that idea. I must admit, this reminds me fondly of a game that I played. Not at all like this, but just a simple idea of playing. I think I played H4, threatening G3. And that was a similar idea I used against Kenny Solomon, I think, at the SA Closed. My first SA Closed. But anyway, very cool idea. H5. So you say, why doesn't have time to really stop this G6 or do anything meaningful?
You can try F4 maybe.
So do you think it's worth playing H5 then? Isn't this dangerous? Okay, let's
see. No, it's a little bit dangerous, but...
Can you go? Let's see. Dude, this is looking very interesting because, I mean, F4, you can even allow F takes E and then D takes E and then the knight.
Yes. On D. But, yes, something like that. This, and then I'm still attacking, on...
D4 because the knight is spent.
Yes.
So, yeah, things are heating up here in this position. What would you have considered then?
I think maybe I didn't consider H5 because I was also worried about F4. Then you can't play, yes, because, you know, I want to gain the piece, a full piece. I don't want to, you know, I'm getting this diagonal open here. This diagonal open.
Yeah.
On, I'm getting it so that you can, if it does take. But I think I can run away with my knight. I'm not sure where can I put my knight now?
Maybe D7.
D7, so that I still have my G6.
Yes, and then the knight on D4 will be hanging, and there's still the pin, and oof,
yes,
starting so to pile up for
white. Okay, for example, let's say knight D7, he still has to, yes, and then I can play my G6,
and then the knights are embarrassed, basically.
Yes.
Okay, so that looks stronger, yeah, it looks strong.
So I said, let me get my piece as quickly as possible. Let me gain it as quick as possible before it runs away. So I played G6.
Sorry, Rodwell, just to comment here on Scariest Name's suggestion, maybe King H7 with the same idea is possible, but it kind of looks a bit odd with that bishop on C2. I don't know if it will play.
Also, but it's maybe the moment you do that, no, but also the queen can go to queen h3 now.
Ah, okay. And now g6 isn't possible at all with this.
Yes.
Okay. That makes it clear. So maybe not king h7. Nice idea, similar idea, but maybe not there. Barbecue was suggesting bishop takes d4. Is it in this moment? I don't know really if you want to give up your dark squared bishop, Barbecue. That might
No, because that's the strongest piece we do have is black, yeah.
Yeah, so white can basically take with anything he wants to, yeah. Let's say queen takes. Then you're missing your beautiful dark squared bishop. Remember, white is also without a dark squared bishop, so now that gives extra value to this dark squared bishop, because who's defending the dark squares for white in the long run? So maybe not bishop takes d4, Barbecue. King Luster says h5, nice prophylaxis. Okay, cool. So h5 not played. What did you play?
I played g6.
G6, right. So first thing is that I noticed h6 is hanging.
Then takes.
Yeah.
Then king g7.
Okay.
Now the knight doesn't have any square, but he's now playing forced moves. It's easy to find forced moves, is it?
Yes. So what? Wait, I was just reading a comment here by Barbecue. Sorry, Rodwell. Okay. That's what she was meaning. Bishop takes d4. She wanted to play knight f3 check, but yeah, no, things are not working out in that tactic. I see the idea there, Barbecue, with bishop takes and then knight f3, but it doesn't work there. Okay, so yes, king g7. So the knight can't go to g4 over here.
He can't go anyway, but...
Can't go anyway, yeah.
Yes. But now he's forced to sacrifice it now. He's forced to sacrifice the knight. Mm-hmm. Is he?
Yes.
Yes. Now there's a forced sacrifice. Otherwise, if I don't take, I have to take.
Yes.
Then take.
And it doesn't look too horrible for white if you think about it.
Yes. It's only that he just needs a... if he does manage to get a rook lift, then I'm in trouble.
Yes. Okay.
At the moment, he does have two pieces, a queen and a knight. And then I said I have three pieces, king, queen, knight. So I don't think he's going to checkmate me. Yes. So, yes.
All right.
So the best he can get is a draw. So I think, okay. So check, and then queen g3, knight g6. So I'm trying to hold the piece, utilize it, h4. But it's not enough. It's not easy to get...
just coming back, Rodwell, sorry I'm breaking the momentum here, but there's just another question from the viewers here. So they're saying here, instead of knight f5, king Mick says instead of knight f5, queen h3. I think that might be a blunder, king Mick, because the knight on d4 is hanging, and we have this rook h8 idea.
Yeah, rook h8 as well.
So I think queen h3 might be a huge problem, just piling on more problems for yourself. So, but thanks for asking. Check takes King G8, check Knight G6 and H4. Whoa.
Yes. Yeah.
So at this moment, Rodwell, are you still feeling like you're winning? Or what's the situation?
Okay, I'm not sure. At the same time, I'm saying, but I'm pissed up.
Yeah, so at least you're thinking, okay, worst case scenario, maybe draw or whatever. Even if you lose your piece, yeah, okay.
Yes, I'm saying no. I can't lose this game, but at the same time, I can't draw this game, boss. But I've got a piece. Can you see that?
Yes,
I've got a piece.
Yes.
But I was worried about Queen takes D6. I said, oh no, again.
Because what now? You 2 pawns down, and another one will drop, perhaps.
Yes. So, but Queen takes D6. I think I had to take on something like on B2 or something like that.
Sure. Now it becomes messy. So Queen D6. Let's just briefly look at it. Queen D6.
So Queen D6.
You say maybe Queen B2.
Yes.
And
I think there's also H5.
Sure. What's going on here? Okay. Queen C7, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, there's also Queen C7. So
Bishop B8?
No, Bishop B8, there's Bishop B6.
Ah, okay. Yeah, I like Bishop C5. And the queen, but the queen goes back to G.
Okay. No, I think, yeah, Bishop B8, Queen B6, Queen E5, threatening mate 2.
Aha, okay. F4, is that a possibility?
No, I don't think so. Maybe G3, you can just go G3. I still have problems along the 6th rank.
Yes. Very complicated.
Yeah, this was...
What we're missing. But of course, the GM also must have seen something here that... That you can do.
Okay, Bishop C5. Bishop C5. Where is he going to put the queen back to G3? Is it?
Uh huh. And then in the meantime, you but G7 is covered, eh?
No, but where I'm going to put my knight?
You can't move your knight.
Yes.
What about?
Where am I going?
What about? This is not so easy.
Queen, I can't play queen. It's
what about? Yeah, I was thinking about queen e5, but.
The knight is defending. Yes.
Interesting stuff here. Let's just see.
Yes. So let's say even after queen takes d6, because I was thinking of taking on b2, I was thinking of even taking.
Yeah.
Then rook c7, but it's got 3 pawns. Yes.
Yeah, but okay. It's not lost. 3 pawns is.
Yes.
It's balance. It's balanced. So maybe he didn't like this as well. Yeah.
Yes.
And remember, you still have that monster dark sword bishop. It's not so easy. Bishop control is not a squeeze.
It's not opposite colored, which I think also does give me some edge.
Yes.
Yes.
So yeah. Okay. Interesting.
King H8. So queen G4. Now there's queen H5. So. I was worried about somehow when he plays H5, and then there's knight E7 check somewhere, so I need to win that E7 square.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So queen check, yeah.
Oof. So the guy is still coming.
Saying, yeah.
He's still coming one way.
So now I was not sure what to do now. What should I do? Because he could have played knight check, king h. I was going to run away because I'm not, I want to win.
Yes. Yes. So knight h checks, king f8, and then king there.
Yes.
Okay.
So now my bishop is a little bit stuck here. I need this bishop to be here.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Yes. So that's why if you go back here, that's why I didn't want to play like something like rook e8 or rook e7 or something or rook d8 so that I can play my bishop move here. Because the moment you have this check and this now.
And then you can't really decide what's happening now. Okay.
Now it's a draw. He's going to go for a draw. Yeah. So I have to run away from the draw. So I'm running out as possible. So
okay.
I'm taking my chances also.
Yes, interesting stuff.
Okay.
So queen H6.
Then queen H6. So now I need bishop C8. Now I said, now I need bishop C8, but I don't have time for that. Oops. I don't know what happened here.
It's fine. Bishop C8. Wait. Where are we now?
Yes, yeah. Move number 32. Bishop D4.
Bishop D4?
Yes. I played bishop D4 to defend my queen. So if H5, there's a threat here of H5.
Yes.
Attacking here. So that was the threat anyway. Queen H6, this H5, pinning against the queen.
Yes.
Yes. So bishop D4, defending my queen. At least my knight can go to F8. But I wasn't happy with this variation, to be honest. Class, and I wasn't.
I'm actually going to ask you now. H5 came and then you...
Happy, to be honest.
You didn't move the knight. To be
honest. I wasn't happy because after queen takes, bishop takes.
Wow. Ooh, and knight takes D6.
Yes, I wasn't happy with this variation, to be honest.
Oof, and now you're still forced to move your bishop or protect it or what?
Yes. So if I lose this bishop for nothing, I'm going to be 3 points down. So I have to try something like what? I don't know.
Bishop or rook C7?
Rook C7 is, I'm going to drop.
Oh, no, you can't go rook C7. Oh, my word. Yeah, no, it's... Let's assume, bishop A8 and then just you take and then you can still protect over there. Okay.
Okay, but that's what happened. I didn't do that, actually. I said, no, I'm not going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So H5, I took on B2.
Okay. Yes. So you're giving the piece back, but in the meantime, you're getting B2 and you're going to get the H-pawn.
Yes. Then like that.
Okay. So what has happened now? The position has transformed. His pawn's equal now, all of a sudden.
Yeah, I was supposed to take with the queen. Queen takes was more accurate, actually.
Okay, just to go into this end game or suggest going into this end game with the bishop here.
Yes, so queen was queen D was more accurate. Okay. But anyway, pawn takes, keep the knight. So then, so yeah, I was thinking maybe bishop F4, then pawn takes, bishop F4 with queen H3, and then take, and then pawn takes. Bishop F4,
yeah,
queen H3. Now I can go king,
G7?
King, yes, I have to play something like queen here. Yeah.
Why can't you go king G7 because of knight G4 or what?
King G7, yes, then it's going to be attacked immediately.
Okay.
My queen, where I'm going to place it.
Okay, I see.
Yes.
Okay.
Boys, for you, I don't know where I'm going to place my queen now, to be honest.
Yeah, it's a bit.
Knight, yeah. So where should I place the queen? It's difficult. You don't have any good square for the queen, is it?
Queen G5, maybe?
Then there's this.
And then after you move the bishop, then just F4 or what?
Yes. So there's, maybe there's F4, yeah. Even if you play bishop e5, then bishop e5, f4, then bishop d4, check, king g2. Yes.
Okay.
Wasn't happy. So okay. I said, no. So now I was no longer sure now what you are. That's okay, let me just play what is there on the board again. So queen g5, rook c7, knight g4, bishop c8, takes. Now I wasn't so sure about the game anymore.
Okay, and by the way, what's the time looking like now? Because your opponent was in 15 minutes a long time ago. What's the time looking like now, if you can recall?
The time, if I still remember well, after in this position, I had 1 minute.
Sure.
Then he's with 2 minutes.
Okay, so the man has equalized on the clock with you. Okay.
Yeah, but now it's in move number 39 now, so it's just have to make a
time
move.
Control. Okay,
Normally, you make mistakes around this time, 38, 39,
yes,
40.
And by the way, for the viewers out there, this time control at the Olympiad and many top tournaments, Rodwell is talking about move 39, move 40 at the Olympiad. I don't know, what's the starting time? You get an hour and a half aside, eh? Or what do you get at the beginning?
Yes, 1 hour, 30 minutes, plus 36
increment. Plus a 36 increment. And then at move 40, you actually gain another half an hour. Added to your clock just to be able, they call that, they give that just to so that you can finish off the game. That half an hour sounds like a lot, but a lot of times if you've been playing a game like this and you get that extra half an hour, like Rodwell only has 1 minute or 2 minutes left, that half an hour, you're tired, you played a long game, that half an hour flies by quickly as well if you're in a tough situation. So, but yeah, interesting way of playing over there with the time. So, rook takes e5.
And, was a mistake because here I was thinking of queen takes, actually. I was thinking of queen takes because one move number 39. I was thinking of queen takes. It was an interesting idea so that if he does take, then g7. Then I've got pieces which can swarm on the key. I've got bishop h3 in some other lines.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So, yes. Bishop h3. Then along the g, yes. Very because, yeah, he doesn't have enough, he's good, does have only queen.
Yeah, and now he's the only one, he's the guy with no pieces around this king. And you've got all your pieces there. Okay.
Yes. Then I said,
it's not an easy decision to make at that moment, yeah.
At that moment, but the moment he does survive until move number 40, you're screwed.
Yeah. Yes. I get you. Okay.
So but instead anyway, rook takes e5 was a mistake because after queen here, and then king h7, he can take on d6.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Now I'm pulling down now.
So queen takes d6.
Queen takes d6. He didn't play it for some unknown reason.
Oh, he didn't play that.
He didn't play that.
And that was after he got the time.
Yes. No, because he has to play queen takes d6. Is move number 40.
Interesting.
Where is it?
I'm not so sure what's going to happen now after queen takes d6.
Because I'm just pure pawn down here. Yes.
Yeah, okay. So maybe he missed a chance there as well, but I mean you also missed your chances over there.
Yes.
Okay.
So now I'm sitting.
But I mean, these type of matches is also all about psychology. And it's like I said, it's a long match. You're going blow by blow. The GM was a piece down. He got his piece back. And now he needs to still reach the time control. He was low on the clock for a long time. So all these dynamics play a part during the game, just to give a picture.
Yes, probably he missed his picture from what happened in the previous couple of moves back.
Yes. Sometimes you also start believing your opponent as well. Sometimes if your opponent is playing very aggressive and enterprising, then sometimes you believe your opponent. Okay, I can't take this because he's been playing strong the whole time. He's been taking me head on. So also, I think just your I don't know if you want to call it bravado at this moment.
Just
bluffed him away from taking the pawn. So that's not easy as well. To bluff a GM like that.
Okay. Yeah.
So he didn't play queen, he played f4. But I mean, maybe he's thinking maybe he can take on d6 afterwards. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I think that was his plan because I played queen e7.
Aha. So maybe he missed that move.
Yes.
Ruan, chess master Ruan is on the show. Is on the show as well. Welcome. So queen e7, nice move. The rook is hanging, but you're hitting his queen over there.
Yes. So I managed to take and then take.
Okay, so I just want to ask you, Rodwell, now it seems like we've reached now a different phase of the game. And the reason why I asked you to show this game as well is because when I checked out this game, it was amazing to me to see all these different phases of the game. The opening, how interesting it was, bishop d6. You had to do some uncomfortable moves over there to untangle. Then in the middle game, g6 enterprising chess, sacking a pawn, being a piece up for a while, and then all of a sudden you're giving the piece back. And now all of a sudden, as the dust clears, what do we have here? Is it an equal end game, material wise?
Yes, equal material wise. Yes.
Sure.
But to assessment, it's very difficult. You don't know what's happening here to assess this kind of positions.
Uh-huh.
Not easy. Yes. because you're dealing with central pawns versus outside pawns. Mm-hmm. So central pawns tend to prevail.
Yeah, they are more urgent usually at the beginning.
So, yes, the central pawns. Because yes. For you to play, you need to play along the center. So yes. That's why, yes. So the moment you play your rooks, you do lose tempo along the way. Maybe you're getting attacked or, I don't know, with the pawns.
Yes. Okay, so yes. Rook takes and white. It's white to go. What did he do?
So after rook e7, he played e5.
Oh, and he's going immediately.
Yes, of course I can take it. But when he played e5 immediately, of course, yeah, because of d6. Okay, I wasn't worried much about, I knew this move is going to come, but because I can't stop it.
Yeah.
But I was happy because I don't think this move can come anytime. This e5 at some point, it can come anytime.
Okay.
But it gave me, if you look carefully, where am I going to put the bishop?
Bishop doesn't have squares except maybe b7 or g4.
Yes, yes. Those are the two squares. But if you look, g4 is maybe it can easily get attacked by king. H2, yeah, G3, F2, G3.
Doesn't seem like it's going to do much on G4.
Yeah. Yes. So, I don't
know. D7.
Yes. So, the moment he played E5, I was a little bit happy that because now my bishop does have squares now.
Yes, so okay.
I played rook C5, attacking the pawn. So, of course, you can't take on D6. Otherwise, I'm just going to attack.
D7 and you recollect the pawns nicely, nice and easy. Okay.
So rook c5, and then rook d1. So you know this kind of a thing. Now you start to, you are no longer sure about the position because the assessment is now difficult. And after 3 hours now, you are now happy. I think I can draw now. You know that kind of thing.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what's happening now.
Yeah, yeah.
I think I'm pretty happy with the draw, but you're trying to push for a win, but it's not clear how I'm going to get a win yet.
Yes. Okay.
But you know, at Olympiad, the good thing about Olympiad, you know, there's no draw until move number 30, which does give you, so after some 30 moves, you know where the game is going to go.
Yes.
So those draw agreements are out of the window.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm. Okay.
So you're forced to fight from move number 1 until move number 30. If it's unclear, yes. Then, but from there, after 30 moves, the game, you can know where exactly it's going.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Okay, so rook d1.
So rook d1, bishop g4.
Okay.
Then rook d4. So here I was now playing my opponent now.
Okay. All right, interesting. So what's going on in your mind now? What's happening here?
Okay, a5. Okay, later on, then e6.
So, of course, you need to get your stuff rolling on the queen side. Your main trump is the queen side.
So for him, I knew that he's going to try to play F4 somehow so that he can play on the what? On the king side. Mm-hmm. So that's why I needed bishop F5 and bishop G4. So now he missed this move now, king G7. I played king G7. Otherwise, I didn't want to play B4. A4, if I play B4, my pawns won't go any far because I have to play C3, but still it's going to be stopped. I can't play A4, so I have to play king G7 so that I can see where is he going to go with his plan.
Okay.
Yes. And also king, if I manage to get king E7, then I think I'm good. So king F6, then rook move away, and then king E7.
Just to blockade those passports, and then you can actually use your rook actively.
Yes.
Okay.
But here there was a trick. I set up a trap.
All right.
Yes. So yeah, I did set up a trap. The trap was, so for him to make a progress, he has to push pawns. But he didn't realize pushing pawns is going into a trap.
Okay. And you feel you feel like in this position, it feels almost like it's a race. You feel like pushing pawns is very urgent. You must get rolling. So it's a nice psychological trap as well that you're setting over.
Yes.
Okay.
So, because the moment if I play king f6,
you're kind of stopping b7, his break as well. After king f6, it's very difficult for him to do anything.
Yes. So, he played f5, which was the mistake, which was the last blunder you know, the one who makes the last blunder is going to be the loser. Yeah. So this was the last blunder, so I didn't give him the one. So this was the last mistake he made. So okay. G takes F5.
Thanks.
Bishop takes F5. Pawn takes F5. Rook takes F5. He missed this move.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. So now... This was the move.
It's now... equal. It's equal. He's going to regain his pawn back. But now the pawn formation has changed big time.
Yes. Nice setup over there. So before we continue here, what do you think? What should white have done here instead of F5?
Instead of F5?
King F2? Is it too slow?
Yes, maybe King F2 so that he can chase away. But the moment I get King F6 and Bishop F5, it's kind of also another situation because he has to now stop my pawns now with the rook.
But there's an interesting idea there here that I was looking at. Okay, not with King F2. Let's say white played something else. Imagine, I just want to make a silly move here. Let's say white played G3. Yes, I know this doesn't make sense. If King F6, then this F5 move might be interesting here.
Yes. That was no, but I was going to take with the bishop. Then if G4, king is going
king
to go
e5. And yes. You hit the rook. Okay.
But
okay.
Also no, there's pawn takes, and then king takes, and then this.
Ooh, okay. So, yes, but yes. Of course you can time the king f6.
Yes. It's not no, I was sure about this move. I was pretty sure about this move. Yes, mm-hmm. I was.
Nice. I was nice setup sure about over this there. Move.
Yes.
Okay. So, and also looks like you're just dodging this bishop over there. You don't want to. Yes. You don't want any trouble.
Yes.
Okay.
No, King F6. I know. I had to time it actually.
But I yes. mean, considering this, all of this, I mean, it is difficult to find a move for white.
It's not easy.
Because what do you do? You can't go King F2 because that just allows King F6 easily. Now there's no tactics on the F file. Maybe king h2.
Okay, then king h2, then I was going to play a b4 move. If king g3, then bishop f5,
and then you eliminate the bishop or attempt to eliminate the bishop. And then
because the moment I play bishop f5, I'm eliminating the defender of the c passed pawn.
Yes,
and my king is closer to the to his passed pawn because something like this, king h2. B4, king g3, bishop f5, let's say takes, bishop takes, pawn takes. Now I do have this passed pawn here. So his king has to cross over so that it can be similar to mine. Mine is
yours is much, much closer to this one. Yeah. Okay.
Yes. And if you look, this rook has to keep an eye on this pawn, which is also another problem.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, because for him, yes, to if you look carefully, white is to attack the base of this of my pass of the of this pawn chain, maybe. Yes, starting from here.
Oh, I don't know how. Yeah, it's too deep.
Yes, so mine, I can bring my king to e7, then rook b7, rook b5, attacking the pawn on d5. Then the pawn c3, c2 can come. The moment it brings rook c1, I'm taking the d5 pawn, then c3. The king comes to f6.
Yeah.
There's a problem on the d5 pawn.
Okay, yeah. So it doesn't look so exciting for white in any event, if he self-played it.
So, okay. But anyway, so I think this was my plan, if I still remember well, this was my plan, how I'm going. Because I'm fighting for a win, I need to get a win.
Yes.
If you because my board two had won, then
Okay, your board 2-1 in that match.
Yes.
Who was board 2 for you guys?
Emerald was.
Ah, okay. Two.
Yes. So then board 3 lost, board 4 draw. So I had to win.
Okay. Nice match situation over here.
Yes. So I had to win so that we can take. So draw was not enough for us to win. It was just a draw for their team.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. So now, after,
he plays. So the moment he plays the f5, okay, takes, bishop takes, take, and then rook e6. Yeah, I could see his face that he missed this.
I was about to ask you, what was his reaction? Okay.
He cased himself after this. Yeah, I could see the face. Now he wasn't happy that he lost a pawn.
Mm-hmm.
So then he took immediately. So from here, he didn't put a resistance on the game like the previous moves ago. It was just now a matter of technique.
Okay.
So rook takes d6. So yeah, I had to play accurate. I think the best move is play rook c5 first.
Okay.
Rook behind the passed pawn.
Yes.
Rook behind the passed pawn.
Yes, very
so
important.
If you try to bring rook or king f6, he can have some chances with rook c6 defending and rook passed pawn.
Yes, I get you.
Yes.
Okay.
So after, because if king f6, I can play rook c6. Now this a4.
Very nice.
See.
Very
yes,
nice.
Now this a4. And so you can play also a reckless move like this, then a4.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's kind of a tricky. Yeah. So
rook c5 is
takes,
important.
Takes, then rook c5. So. If d6, if e7, of course,
king f7, yeah,
rook d7, there's king f6, so there's nothing here for
five. So the e6 is just basically a weakness now,
yes. You just gonna play rook e1, then this
seven.
Last king e7,
mm-hmm.
Yes. Now he's so king f2, c3. Then also this was
also a nice looking move over there, cutting off
yes,
the king.
Make sure cutting off the king, then yeah, and then take the pawn. Now it was just easy to go for another pawn, then and then rook g2, a4. He resigned here after a4.
Okay, lovely. Shoo. And this end game is in general just lost. If imagine this a couple of moves back, if you take away the a pawns. Then the connected pawns wins against the single one on the other side.
Because yes.
Even the rook alone can work, operate with those two for a long time. So yeah, you must have a good feeling at this moment already, and this just puts the icing on the cake over there. So I mean, I think it's a brilliant game, Rodwell. A chess game is all about fighting, and I think there was a lot of fight in this game. And
yes.
Sure.
Because the situation at some point I could have accepted a draw when I played on move number I could accept the draw when I played rook
rook c rook to e8. E8
yes rook,
instead of rook
f8.
F8, yeah
yes I could have allowed that to happen on the board, but I said no. Because I was a piece up, so you know that kind of a thing. I was piece up for
yes.
Then I couldn't utilize it properly.
Yes.
Because I gave him some chances, so then I said, wow.
and that's also something I like, what you're saying right now. And it's I think it's important for everybody to also bear that in mind. If you want to grow in chess, if you want to improve, then you need to strive for victories. I mean, if Rodwell just decided to take the draw there because his opponent is a GM, then what would he have learned? Probably half of what he has actually gotten from this game. And you need to push yourself. I mean, sometimes it's good to take a loss if you're going to learn a lot from it. Rather push. I'm not saying, depending on the tournament situation, of course, sometimes you need to secure something. But that attitude alone is very important. And sometimes, and this is what this lecture series is all about. This lecture series is not about bashing GMs. Because GMs is the title of Grandmaster, that is what we all strive for, and that's what we want to achieve. And of course, Grandmasters a lot of times seem invincible, especially to us here in South Africa, for many, many years up until recently, where Kenny Solomon became a Grandmaster. Unfortunately, he doesn't reside in South Africa at the moment. But I mean, for us, not having Grandmasters really in the country really makes it difficult to even fathom the idea of beating a GM. So just this idea that Rodwell is saying that no, he doesn't want a draw, or he wants to keep on fighting, This is the type of attitude that you should strive for in order to achieve something, and that's very inspiring, Rodwell, to hear that from you. Not being happy was just throwing.
Yes. No, but most of the cases, like when you play against a grandmaster, they don't give you, you know, it's not easy to even to get a draw. It's not easy.
Yes.
Even get that draw. Because most of the times when they give you a draw, probably they're not happy with the situation that you have on the board.
Yes.
That's when you also must try to also what and try to push for a win. But at the same time, it's not easy to get to be in that kind of situation, to be in the first place, that's in that kind of situation where you're in control of the situation. That's where you need to fight for. Because the moment you get that kind of situation where you need to decide should I get a draw or not, that's a good start.
Yes.
Because you can choose what you want.
Yes, yes. So yes, a couple of comments in the chat box. Master Ruan, Chess Master Ruan saying tournament was great fun, Calvin. Thanks Ruan for joining again this morning. Dr. Queenie WIM says great technique. Well done, Rodwell. Great technique. Kingelster says, what a roller coaster. Thanks, Rodwell and Calvin. And Dr. Queenie WIM says, great attitude. That is the mark of a champion. Thanks for the comments there, Dr. Queenie WIM. And Babiki says, very interesting stuff. So, yeah, Rodwell, like I said, this series is about inspiring people. I think you definitely inspired me. You also don't need to play perfect chess. Grandmasters are also human beings, and it's about, like you said, who makes the last blunder. And the grandmasters are also human. I think that's the first thing that we all need to realize. And like I said, it's not about bashing GMs. Everybody wants to become a GM, and this is just an eye opener to everybody out there to show you that things are possible. And I fully enjoyed this. Do you have any last comments on the game or anything you want to add or any interesting stories? That you guys did great at Olympia, didn't you, Zimbabwe?
Yes, okay, that was our great one of the greatest, actually maybe yes, the greatest Olympiad we played as a team, the Zimbabwean team.
This last Olympiad in Batumi.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah, the other one was,
because I also remember you had a nice one. You had a nice one in Baku as well, didn't you? Zimbabwe has been performing brilliantly actually in the last the ones that I can remember recently. So
no, we crumbled it, the one in Baku, we crumbled it.
How did you crumble? I remember you guys played Egypt last round. How was that crumble?
Yeah, that was just that was bad.
Just to get into that position, I mean, you guys beat us in the previous round, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So I mean, and there you beat another GM. You beat Kenny Solomon in the previous encounter, in the previous match, eh?
Yes. You know, that one was probably the worst Olympiad I played. Actually, it was difficult for me. Yes. Baku one was the worst. Okay. For experience wise, it was good. To be honest, I think that's where I got the most experience.
Okay.
I think I played an average of 2,600 players. Yes, because I played Kasim Danov. And I was
I remember that game.
Kasim Danov, and then I played Mamedjarov, and then I played Amin, then I played...
in the same Olympiad?
Yes.
Phew, I played, sounds nice.
I think I played only two, how many games? I think one from Ecuador and Aruba and Kuwait. Only three games with nine GMs.
What? Okay. I played eight games
with James. Then the rest, eight games with James, the rest were also,
Wow. Like that. Okay, I need to check that Olympia because that sounds amazing. Yeah. You probably became stronger after that tournament.
Yes, I think I got demoralized after the Olympiad. Because I had high hopes, to be honest, for that Olympiad. High hopes. Yes. Okay, against Mamedjarov, I didn't...
That was a crazy game.
Good experience, good exposure.
Yeah.
Then the one which I didn't do, which I wasn't happy about, was the game against... which team from... the team from Bosnia-Herzegovina.
Yeah.
Kadrik Denis. I did outplay the guy in the opening.
Yeah.
It was just a matter of, you know, that kind of extra thing that I wanted to just... because it was just, you know, I had a good position, but I just, you know, where the computer is showing you like plus three, plus four, but it's equal. But it's equal.
I get you.
Then at the same time, that position, me, I can feel it that I'm winning this position.
Yes.
Then I started to play like, bad.
I guess, I mean, the GMs, I remember it was, I think it was Kramnik. I checked out this DVD on Kramnik. It was released a long time ago, but he was talking about how he got into the highest level in chess. But before that, he was playing against regular GMs. And then when he got to the highest stage with Karpov them and these top, and he said, what's the difference between Karpov them and the normal GM? Is that level of resistance that they give you, even when you think you're winning, you want to step away from winning, then it just comes up with last move to stay in the game. And that level of resistance sometimes makes you crack at the wrong moment. I'm assuming that you can take that theory a step lower to us as well and just say, like, what's the difference between us and GMs? Sometimes GMs are just a bit more resilient, a bit more resistant.
For sure, yes. Because all of a sudden, that guy just got a winning attack just from nowhere. I don't know how I played, then I lost the game. Okay. Then in the previous round, I played Kasimdanov, long game again.
Oh, classic. I would love that matchup. I think it was like a Catalan with G6, eh?
Yes. Boys, the funny thing, I don't know, I looked at that line before the round. I said, you might play this because I saw one or two games playing that line. I said, okay, let me just forget it.
But that position was equal for a long time. He like grinded a long, long time.
You know what? I had so many options of drawing, but I was looking for the most difficult one.
I know you. I know what you mean. Yeah. Sometimes
I was looking for the most difficult way to draw. The most difficult way to draw. I was pawned down, but there's a way I can draw this game. Okay, the way I learned from that game, I can tell you, is repetition. He taught me a good repetition, how to do repetition, the Russian way. You know, where you repeat two moves, then change. Repeat moves, then change.
And you're grinding your opponent like that. Grinding.
Then get extra time again.
Yes.
So then you think, I'm about to get a draw. Then change. You know, that kind of a feeling, you know?
Yes.
So I lost, that game was equal. If I still remember well, I went back to my hotel room and checked the game on Chess Bomb. On Chess Bomb, it was showing, you know, blue, and grayish, blue, and grayish, blue, and grayish. There's only one move I played.
It was blue and gray.
It was move number 79.
yo, and the guy so capitalized.
I came all the way with a game where it's equal. Nothing is something, but I blundered on move number 79.
That's tough. That's really tough.
Yes. So it was a sad. It was a sad moment that I lost the game, but also it was a learning opportunity that I learned. Okay, this kind of thing, how to do it, and also how, you know, when you are defending or you are trying to get a result against the GM.
Yeah.
It's not easy, but you do learn how to do it as time goes on. You start to learn how to do it.
Yes. And then it becomes easier as well.
I was able to do so. In the next Olympiad, I was able to get results and able to get those kind of draws.
Yes. And then, like I was saying, it becomes easier once you've done it once, and then it becomes a bit easier and so on. And tell me something. Didn't you beat two GMs at this Olympiad that we were looking at now?
Yes, I did. The other one was the guy from Albania. The guy from Albania is a funny story because we played the same opening from the previous Olympiad. Boys, we played together again.
Round. Interesting. What?
It was round four in Baku, and it was round four in Batumi.
What? Crazy stuff. Crazy.
Yes.
So what was the result in the previous one?
The previous one was a draw.
Okay.
But I think I had an edge, a very good edge, but I had to play like a stockfish there.
Okay. So this time you improved on that line.
No, he played the same variation. Then he changed a little bit. He played some knight.
Okay.
But I got an overwhelming advantage. You know, when, you know, now it was from the previous Olympiad, I learned how to win when you are plus two, you know, that kind of advantage, when you are plus two, plus three advantage.
Yes.
But with equal material. So I learned, so I learned how to nest those kind of what? Those kind of position.
Yes. Okay.
So I learned from the previous Olympiad how to win now. So now, okay, now I know how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I knew I've got an advantage, but how should I turn this advantage? So I was now patiently playing correctly.
Brilliant.
Waiting. Yes.
Brilliant.
Until I got to the right moment, then I attacked properly.
So, I mean, it just sounds like it's an invaluable experience that you're gaining from these Olympiads.
Olympiad, it's an opportunity, especially from us, where we are far away from most of the Grandmasters, where you play with these Grandmasters. Because, you know, for us, it's a one-time opportunity, and you must utilize it very well. Otherwise, you have to wait for another 2 years to get that same kind of opportunity.
Yes, definitely. Yes. I get you.
Yes.
And you know, so, what? Yeah, you know, continue.
So, you know, you must utilize it very well. And the gems are there for the taking because of our style. They're not used to the way we play.
Mm-hmm.
Then, we do tend to, we must utilize it, especially for us. We must utilize it very well. Because, you know, the gems, they're not well used to our kind of, play. Maybe the European way, you know, that kind of style. For us, it's just, we don't have like a way, but we do have like our own different way from the rest of the players.
Yeah, and you know what, I fully understand you about getting this opportunity once in a while, and I must admit, at the last Olympiad, I was also playing there, and I was thinking, okay, I'm having a very nice one myself. I also beat two grandmasters at that Olympiad. And then I'm over the moon, and then I hear, Rodwell also beat two grandmasters. And I'm like, oh, okay. it's a normal thing.
So, yes, it's an opportunity because, it's an opportunity to beat those grandmasters. It's an opportunity. We just need to take another step further, whereby we do get to get norms out of it.
Yes, and actually, that's one of my and that's probably my last question I want to ask you about this. Subject is so do you still have any aspirations? Are you aiming for that GM title anytime soon? And what do you think we should be doing as chess players in this country and in Africa in general? What should we be looking at doing to get to that level? It's possible. We've seen it with us beating grandmasters on occasion, but what do you think? What's necessary, and are you still aiming for that?
No, you know, I still have aspirations to become a Grandmaster, but it's a difficult journey to get that title because you do need three. At the moment, I'm sitting on zero norms, GM norms.
Okay.
But
I'm part
Olympia
of that club.
Olympia does give you double.
Yes, of course.
Yes. So Olympia, since it does give you double, it's easy to, you know, to jump quickly from someone who doesn't get that kind of opportunity of a Olympiad opportunity.
Yes,
so you can easily get one somewhere at another tournament, then before Olympiad, and then go to the Olympiad, then get two. You're already a gem. It's doable, but it's only that you do need it works. Is, you know, if you're going to the Olympiad, your team needs to help you too. Your team does need to help you. Otherwise, if the team is not doing performing well,
then you can't
playing,
get the games that you want to get.
You end up playing each other, South Africa, Zimbabwe, what are we?
Yeah.
Yes.
I get you.
Yes. Because you want to play. Because my previous Olympiad, the one in Batumi, I needed to play a GM in the last round. Can you see?
Uh-huh.
I'm now looking for a pair chess here on chess pairing that I have to play a GM. So I was hoping to get a GM. There was a GM who was close to me. I was hoping to get that GM. Yes, I was hoping for a 2-5 guy in my last round.
Who did you end up playing last round, by the way, if I may ask?
I ended up playing like a 2-2.
Okay.
So I was looking for a GM in the last round. So I was, this is not what? This is not good. But anyway, I was just hoping for the best. Then after the calculation, I was just short by 20 points.
That is so sad. Yeah.
Fine margins, with 20 points, 20 rating points.
Yeah, but okay.
So just imagine if that 2-2 was a 2-4.
Yeah, then it was, that
big difference, isn't it? Yes.
Okay, no, but Rodwell, actually, I just want to thank you for joining us on the show. It was very entertaining, like we can see from the chat box as well. The people were entertained, and I looked at, like I said earlier, I looked at this game briefly, and I couldn't decipher everything. There's so many things that happened. So thanks for entertaining us. Thanks for showing us this marvelous game, how to beat a grandmaster. And thank you. And hopefully you can join us on the channel at some point again.
I'm open, Calvin. It was a pleasure to be here with you, and this kind of opportunity in this lockdown, we do need to entertain people and show us how we do beat grandmasters. It's a inspiration to inspire other people. It's doable, and just if you do work, you are able to to get results.
But
if you don't work, if you don't work, you don't expect miracle to happen. It doesn't work like that. Yes, so there's no shortcuts. You do need to work. And during our time, the way we grew up, there was no this kind of a thing. Where you see stock in front of you.
Yes.
You don't get that sort of things. As we just have to think over the board. Boys, I still remember back then, I had an informant, old informants used to give us saying plus or equal plus,
yes,
the minimum advantage.
Yes.
So as you start to find what happened here, you are trying to, but still you're not even understanding how did you lose?
Yeah.
You're not even understanding.
Yes.
So that was then, the way informant taught us was also another book which I learned from the informant. It was a hard way of learning how to assess the position, but we're still not understanding. Both informant were just ridiculously difficult to understand because of their assessment of giving those kind of signs. It's equal.
Yeah.
But you don't understand how is it equal?
But okay, on the good side, I mean, nowadays you also have people that just look at the signs on Stockfish and so on, and they just take the moves, and they our brains become lazy. We don't analyze anymore. We do let the engines do everything, and that can also be detrimental to your growth.
What I've realized, I met a GM or saw somewhere where there is no point of looking at the computer if you are just less than 2400. That's what they said. Then I never touch the computer.
Nice.
So there's no point for sure. Yes. There's no point. Because to be honest, at our level, we can't play like a computer.
Yes.
Even our preparation is not like we have to find something really good which is going to beat this guy. Mm. Because it's not even enough. It's more than enough. What do we do? It's more than enough to beat anyone at our level. You know, at 2300 and below. It's enough. But at a higher level, when I'm playing, let's say, Grandmaster, that's when maybe the computer, that's where it's what it's required.
Yes.
Because, yes, as we do look at the engine, knight takes f5. Oh, wow, that's a great move. But
then afterwards, nothing.
Understand that move? Computer that do give ridiculous moves. They do give ridiculous moves. So you need to understand it. Where is it coming from?
Yes.
Yes, boys, I still remember there was a game which I played at the Olympiad in 2012. Me, in my own opinion, I felt this was a good move.
Mm-hmm.
But when I went to the engine and put it there, he didn't like it.
Okay.
Until now, he started to like it after certain minutes or certain hours or an hour or 30 minutes. Oof. That's when he said to appreciate the move.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
So So the committee does give the, because the way it it's programmed, you know, does give the best move, but not the best situation. How are you thinking? You know, you can't give it like that. In our situation, where you, can you play knight g6 blocking the diagonal? If you don't do that, it's a risky move to you because you're not sure how am I going to defend on the king side.
Yes, yes.
But computer, they say, no, don't worry, play c5.
Yeah, so I get you. It's not always good for you to understand the position. So, yeah. Okay, so... Okay, sure. Thanks a lot, Rodwell. I'm going to say thanks to everybody else out there for tuning in. King, the last comment is, King Ulster says, inspired endurance, analysis, and psyche. So, yeah, thanks everybody for tuning in. Thanks, International Master Rodwell Makoto, for showing us this lovely game, how to be the Grandmaster. And, yeah, we will see you next time, guys. Thanks for tuning in. Cheers. Thanks, Rodwell. Cheers.
Sure, thanks. Bye-bye.